Greetings, fellow investigators, and welcome back to our video podcast, Into the Darkness, where my friends and I play the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. I'm your host, Tom Rayleigh. The campaign is entitled The Shadow of Providence. It was written by John Hook, who is also our game master, and this is episode 3. Our recap will be given by Stuart Lipley as his character, Thurston Thursby III. So without any further delay, let's begin our journey into the darkness. Stuart?
Thurston Thursby III, Sensational Journal. Entry, August 25th, 1928. Regrouping in my luxurious suite, Professor Darius Lasko, author Barnabas Aldwin, and myself attempted to clear our heads, ponder what to do next. Barnabas was startled and then attacked by a bizarre globular sand creature that somehow got into my suite. In the ensuing melee, the creature escaped, leaving Barnabas and myself injured. There was a screaming next door, and we discovered, most likely, the same beast had attacked and drained of life and moisture the lady in the neighboring room. Shortly after, our stalwart group headed to the late Dr. Caitlin Bronson's room, and after trying several ways to gain entry, eventually did. We seeked clues as to how to possibly stop the sandy glob creature on the loose before it struck again. We discovered 3 photographs, along with notes. One of the figurines, the red jasper one with the hieroglyphs, might grant some sort of protection from the beast. One photo of an amulet inlaid with an onyx scarab with an unusual language, not ancient Egypt, though. Egyptian, not ancient Egyptian. The last photo, Ibn Hotep's canopic jar and tablet. The tablet tells of a honey seal and blessing with the prayer of Isis, might trap or contain the beast in a container. The professor finds the knot of Isis as well, a symbol of the goddess Isis. All of us, after finding out all too well that 80% of all accidents happen in the bathroom, we carried on and headed to the lobby. When there, we noticed that it was still a little early to meet up with the hotel's photographer to develop the photographs. So, despite my noticeable wounds, we decided to help an affluent couple who were missing their little dog, Muffikins, to the back of the hotel we initially started, then down a metal stairwell we went. A humid and dank atmosphere met us. As we descended into the sub-basement, hot water heaters, electrical equipment, washing machines, all around very loud environment. Our path led out at the hotel's engineer room, where we hoped to find the on-duty engineer for the hotel. We found him, along with Muffikins, both husks of their former selves remained, desiccated, and to our misfortune, the bizarre globular sand creature, much larger now, was there. Fortunately, Professor Lasko and myself, Barnabas, pulled the two of us back before the horrible creature had its way with us.
Dun, dun, dun. And that is where we rejoin the adventure, as Barnabas has pulled you both by your shirt collars and jerked you back into your right minds. And my assumption is that Barnabas is trying to backpedal with you guys out the door of this maintenance, locker room, rest area where they prepare prepare themselves before they start to go and work in and throughout the hotel. And so the sand creature is still there, and you can see it swelling up to a full man's height, and it seems to be like a coalescing, mockery of a man, and the head, again, still has that extended mouth as it's just in ecstasy as it's pulling all that moisture out of the maintenance worker, and is pulling it into itself. And it's looking much less sandy and grainy now, and it's looking much more smooth, you know, as far as the surface of this yellowy, dark creature.
It is becoming a... Do you believe that it is Imhotep come back from the grave? I do not think that this suitcase is going to hold him any longer.
We can't stay here. This is not safe.
No time to talk. Let's go.
Wait, what if we only capture part of him?
Well, let's discuss this back upstairs. This thing's getting closer.
We should call the National Guard. Well, we have to run.
All right. Oh, yeah. You guys turn and beat feet. So it's that long corridor through all the machinery, you know. And again, it's all the machinery's off to one side. The hallway is right up against a concrete, you know, a stone block wall, you know. So you've got that on one shoulder, and then the openness that has, you know, the banks of washing machines and the boiler room area, you know, the boilers and all the hot water stuff, and you know, so just everything is steamy and hot and noisy, you know, things are knocking, you know. So you guys make it down to the end of the hallway, and there's that short metal flight of stairs that kind of exits out of this machinery industrial area and kind of returns you into a hallway that looks much more civilized as it takes you back to the main lobby of the Milton Hotel.
I do not know what we should do.
I wonder if salt would affect them.
We need to find that tablet. There was a prayer of Isis.
How do we have a? We have to see if there's a photograph.
It is now minutes before midnight. It may as well be midnight.
Quickly, we must go find the photographer.
And hope that picture turned out.
If that thing finds another victim or two, it's going to be fully formed.
We have no time to waste. Let's just go.
Exactly.
Because I'm thinking, if its essence is trapped within the sand, if we take part of the sand away, it will not be able to fully form. It may already be too late.
Well, but what we can do right now is to find Flo Bishop, the photographer.
Let's go.
So Flo was working in the wedding reception until midnight, and so now you can see that things are shutting down. The wedding reception is closing. Next door was that geologists convention, and so they're kind of closing. All the geologists are leaving and shutting the doors, and so Flo comes out of the ballroom that she was in, and she's got some equipment under her arms and stuff. Clearly she's kind of broken down the station that she had, and she runs into you guys. She goes, "Oh, excellent. I was hoping to see you out here. Come on this way. This my dark room is just down this way.
Let me help you carry some of the equipment."
You are a gentleman. Thank you so much. And so she basically unloads practically everything into your arms.
Of course.
And then she starts walking off. She goes, please, this way. So you guys head down another aisle, another hallway, and you get into a room, and it looks like there might be like some offices and stuff down here. Hold on just for a sec.
Can you set a timer until bedtime, please?
What time did mommy say? It's 9 o'clock now, so I'm going to only give you 10 minutes.
Okay.
Okay. Bye.
Thank you, bye.
Sorry about that.
That's okay. Oh,
that's awesome.
We were all waving. I don't think
she's, she's quite shy. So yeah, so she goes into an area and you can see like there's a couple of offices and stuff, you know, like maybe there's an office over there for the lead housekeeping, right? You know, that kind of stuff. And then over there is a room and it says it's labeled dark room. So you go inside there and there's like a little office area up front, and then there's a second door. There's a red light or a bulb that is colored red mounted above that door, and so she opens up that door. You know, she puts her stuff down, and she goes, "Do you have the camera?"
Yes.
So you guys give her the camera.
Yes.
Okay. So she takes it. Yep, and she says, there's plenty of room if you guys want to come in. I mean, this is going to take probably about half hour to get the entire thing done.
Yeah, that's
you guys want to stay, or do you want me to come and bring it up to your room? What would you
like? No,
you're most eager to see this.
We must warn you, too, that we think that some of these pictures may be quite disturbing.
Disturbing how?
It was very strange at the time. The lights were flickering. The one girl was, we believe she was murdered.
Oh my.
We need to see what
of the murder on this.
It was the lights were out, and we were hoping that the flash may have captured the picture, may have captured what was happening. So we warned you. We want to take this to the police, but we want to see for ourselves the picture and not bother them if there's nothing.
I don't know. I'm not sure.
It will help the hotel. It will help the people of this town, because if the true reason of what happened is on there, it could save many a people. And you could get credit for developing.
Helping us to identify the murderer.
And there seems to be like a little light turning on in her head, and she's like, "Okay, all right. Let's do this. Everybody in. Come on in. We have to shut the door." So once everyone's in, she shuts the door and she clicks on a light switch, and the room is illuminated in like a blood red. Okay? And so she goes over to a table, and there are several pans with liquid in them. And the room has a very chemical. There's a chemical smell to this room. And she goes. She starts going about her business. Is there anything that you guys want to do while you're in the dark room for the next 30 minutes?
I think we shall just watch what she's doing.
Okay.
I will stand next to the light switch that would turn on the regular lights.
Okay.
I know that would ruin these pictures, and I'm going to make sure no one accidentally hits that.
Okay. All right.
I wanted to take a quick look around the room if there's any grates or any entrances that this thing might be able to, like it did earlier, shift through and sand.
Yeah. Forward. Give me a spot hidden.
It's difficult to see in the red light, but...
98. No, we're good.
Yeah, yeah. Flo begins her work. And so you can see she takes out... There were several plates that she was able to start working with. And so she starts, you know, giving each of these a bath and starts working on it. And, you know time is ticking on this. Soon, you can see that she's... transferred, you know, she's taken things that were negatives and re-exposed them to these other prints, you know, so that you get some full-size 8x10s, right? And so, you know, she starts developing these, and sure enough, suddenly you start getting, and there were several pictures taken, so you're seeing a bunch coming through of different setups, you know, from the exhibit, right? So you see a bunch of different ones. You even see one where you guys are kind of in the background going like this, you know, from the flash. And then there's, you know, the Cedec game board was set up there, right? So, but she does eventually uncover one photo, and you can hear her gasp as this photo comes into clarity. And there you see the photo just has captured Dr. Caitlin Bronson, and she looks like she's being mummified, and there's this you know, sand creature suspended in the air above her, and it's just, you know, kind of draped over her. And, you know, even though it's a still black and white photo, you can almost see and sense the energy that's being pulled out of Dr. Bronson and up into this cloud, you know, sandy cloud creature to view this photograph, which I rightly assume that everyone does.
Oh yeah.
View the photograph, because she went. So you see the photo and you see the image, and it re-triggers the memory of being there. So I need everyone to make another sand roll, please.
22.
That's what I passed. 18.
23. I passed.
Oh, good. Lose one if you passed.
I think, and I say to her, I put my hand on her shoulder and I say, we believe that the artifact that she was displaying was booby-trapped with some sort of acid sand that blasted into her face. But we think this other woman was the one who triggered it. I'm making this shit up.
So so she's, you know, she'd picked up the picture, the photo from the bath that it was in. And then, you know, her hand is just visibly shaking. And then she just lets the picture go. She drops it, you know, floats down and just lands on the top of the chemical water bath. And she backs up to another like supply table behind her. She's knocking things over, and she kind of, you know, startles backwards against the table, and she goes, "What is that? What is that? What is that?" And then she screams. She cuts the air in a scream, and her body starts convulsing, and she starts thrashing around in that corner over there.
Wow,
my dear, it was just a booby trap, please.
All right, everyone, make a sand roll.
Oh no.
No, I failed that.
96. Bad.
I'm going to get the red mess and just knock her head off.
Passed by 1 point.
Passed by 1 point. Let me get to, I got to figure out how much it is. Okay. If you failed, roll a d6. If you passed, lose one.
Down.
Four.
Here also.
Okay. Flo falls to the ground in this room, and so you see this blood red light illuminating her body, and you can see her flesh beginning to desiccate as you now see this creature on her legs. And it's, you know, it's kind of big, and she's just screaming as she's being desiccated before your eyes.
It got in here. How did this happen?
I'm going to grab the water bath and throw it on her.
Okay. The picture, because it was laying on the water bath, the picture in the water bath splash onto her and onto the creature, and you can see the creature begins to recoil.
Doesn't like water, but you can throw the acid and stuff that could ignite. It's flammable. But I try to grab the girl and pull her away from it.
I assist.
Okay, you guys reach down, and this, you know, her arms, and, you know, it's hard to see because there's so many dark shadows and the blood red light. So her arms are out, reaching outwards. You guys reach each and grab each grab an arm.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. And you try and pull her out away from danger.
Yes.
Not me. Yep.
All right. So Barnabas backs up. You guys pull, and each of you hear this sickening crack and pop as you each pull an arm off. Oh, each of you make another sand roll.
There's another.
I'm seeing it, so I probably need to make.
Yeah, yeah. Barnabas, you get one for seeing it.
Yeah, I lose.
You lose.
I fouled up.
Fail.
Yeah.
Thursby, how'd you do?
79 out of much less than my starting 60. I'm down to.
Okay.
Oh God, each of I'm you, down to 31.
All right. Everyone lose a D4 plus one for that.
Only lost 2 points. I guess I was expecting.
Uh-oh. There's 4 plus 1. That's 5. That's a roll, I think.
That is. Give me an idea roll, Thurston.
Turn the lights on.
Dear Lord. Oh no, I made it. No. Oh, that's horrible.
Success. Success.
Yay.
Yeah. So I'm going to just go with easy peasy lemon breezy here. Use my keeper's shield for a quick reference here. Give me a D10 if you would, Thurston.
Alrighty, D10. I have lost about 65% of my sanity so far. Here's a D10, just in one day, a 1.
Thurston, his eyes roll up into his head, and he collapses to the ground, and he's mumbling.
Okay. I try to grab him as he's falling so he doesn't hurt himself.
Yeah, he doesn't hurt himself. And and the creature seems to be recoiling and going backwards into a dark shadow under one of the tables.
I'm going to flip on the light.
Okay, the lights change from blood red to bright white. And you can see some of the photographs that have been being worked on. They start to just start getting blacker and blacker and blacker.
Okay. Well, the ones that haven't gone through the water bath yet.
Right.
Did we get the picture of the tablet?
It was dumped onto the floor, onto the creature.
I grabbed the pictures on the floor that are wet.
Okay. All right. You start scooping them up. You got them.
All right. We have to get out of here.
Did the creature move away from the door?
It did. It's in a far corner away from the door.
So I'm
I did not call the police.
I'm gonna. It's my area. I'm gonna open the door, and try and grab Thurston by the feet and start dragging him out the door.
Okay, yeah. There he goes. He's being drug out.
Quick, grab his hat. It's a nice hat.
All right. So you guys move into that outer room of the dark room, into the office portion of the dark room. What do you do?
What did you throw at him? Was that water?
Just acid? Water. It was water.
I'm going to look. Is there any other water source in here?
Not in this office. So the dark room that you were in, it was fitted with plumbing and stuff like that. Thurston, you start to come out of it, but your head feels foggy.
Oh, my God.
Wake up, my friend.
God, not again. It's loose again.
Give me a luck roll, Thurston.
38. Yeah, made it. Yes.
Okay. So, Thurston, you recall your name. You recall, the essence of who you are. You recall polite society, your stern parents, and you recall what is expected of you. You're just not sure where you are or what's been going on. Honestly, you kind of feel like you've just kind of woken up and you were expecting to be in California. You, in fact, you assume that you're in California right now. Although you don't know who these people are. You don't recognize these surroundings.
Thurston, my friend, please come sit down.
Who are you?
Oh, she's lost his memory. Lovely. We're your friends.
Yeah.
You have had a terrible shock. Please sit down.
Okay. I would like Dr. Darius and Barnabas to each make a credit rating roll.
Pass.
I
failed. Regular pass.
So Thurston, you get a sense that Dr. Darius is probably trustworthy because he seems like he moves in your social circle. Barnabas, on the other hand, you're a little suspicious because clearly he's probably waiting for a tip. Maybe he moved some of your luggage, but you know he's not in your social circle.
Here it is. Suppose.
Thurston. No. You don't understand. You're confused. I am Dr. Darius Lasko, and this is the author Barnabas Aldwin. We are your friends. Do you know where you are?
California, right?
No. You are at the Hotel Milton in Providence, Rhode Island.
Milton. There was some show I was going to see out here.
Yes, that is where you are. But there have been some terrible things happen at the hotel, and you have a
Muffykins runs into the room and runs up to the door and to the outer door to go into the hallway. And as Muffykins runs up to the door, the dog looks back at you guys, and then it leans down. And it squishes under the door and slips into the hallway beyond. Everyone, give me a sand roll.
Oh, hell yeah. Just seeing Muffykins.
I passed that one.
Damn it, I got a 10.
Lose one. If you pass, lose one.
Thurston, we are all going to be blamed on a series of murders.
Lose a D3 if you failed. By the way, I hadn't forgotten. Actually, that's a lie. I did forget, but now I'm remembering that Dr. Darius and Thurston, they also have a phobia or a mania that needs to set in as they've finally kind of come into their right minds. To start with, I would like each of you to roll a D6.
Okay, so I've got 3 more sand. I'm down to only 23 sand left.
Oh, man, maybe I get you into single digits.
Got a 1.
All right, so you rolled an odd number.
What am I rolling against?
Just after you've done your 3 points of sand loss, now do a D6 and just tell me odd or even.
Odd.
Okay, so you both got a phobia. Now each of you roll a percentile and see where you land on the phobia table.
14.
So, Dr. Darius, after your event, oh man, this kind of works with the hallucination that I gave you. When you were in the sub-basement, and you saw your deceased wife and she was blaming you for her death, right? Mm-hmm. You now have, my God, I don't know how to pronounce these things. Tapephobia, T-A-P-H-E phobia. It is a fear of being alive or of being buried alive or a fear of cemeteries. So you have a fear of cemeteries now.
Well, I'm not. Oh, but I go to see my wife. Fuck.
Yes. Yeah, so no, you probably will no longer go to see your wife. No. Thurston, what was your percentile?
It's just like that bitch to move to a cemetery where I can't get to her now.
004.
I don't think she loves me at all.
Okay. And Thurston, you have acquired ancraophobia, A-N-C-R-A-O-phobia. And this is a fear of wind. You have a fear of wind.
I don't want to go outside.
All right. So so those will settle in, you know, later. I'm just kind of thought that for color, give you all that. But yeah, so Muffykins came out of the dark room, ran past you guys, up to the door, looked back at you, leaned down like dogs do, like they're getting really low, and then just went, and then it was this weird squishy sound as Muffykins went under the door and out into the hallway beyond.
Thurston, what? Does that ring a bell now? Do you remember any of this crap? Wake up, man. We can die here.
That can't be. That thing was dead now.
It can be, and it
you remember.
Snap to it.
You remember.
It's coming back. It's coming back.
We can't be here. This is not good. Outside's not good either. It might be windy, but we not here. We need to go.
Let's go quickly. There is something now that troubles me much, much worse. What if this thing multiplies, that it's now it is both the dog and the person. Now it is, soon it will be more people.
Did it come out of the picture? That's what I'm wondering. We might need to destroy that picture too.
How could it come out of the picture? Don't be ridiculous.
Where did it come from?
It must have come out of a vent or something in the room. I think we are becoming irrational. Perhaps this is all a hallucination. Let's reassess. We should all carry glasses of water so that we can. Doesn't seem to like water.
Question for the keeper?
I was replying.
Oh.
Oh.
The Muffykins. Muffykins is small enough to fit in one of the cases. We could try trapping Muffykins in your suitcase from Dr. Caitlin. It's not all of them, but it's one of them. Or maybe it is, the essence of it is in Muffykins now. And we can trap Muffykins because Muffykins is small.
Then what I think we should do is try and trap Muffykins. Let's call it the sand demon. And I was thinking about the honey. What the honey does is it keeps the sand grains from getting through the cracks in the teeth. And then we should take it to the university, perhaps take it back to Miskatonic University and show it to some scientists and say, what the fuck is this? And how do we kill it? Because it's all over the Providence, Rhode Island. It's no big deal if we lose Providence, Rhode Island to this thing, but
can't lose Miss, you know.
Yeah, we don't want to lose. We don't want to lose Massachusetts.
My question for the keeper: we're on the same level as the receptions at the reception and the geology thing.
Yes, you're on what's basically level 2 of the hotel. Yeah.
If I walk over, can I look into the door of the wedding? What's left of it? Is there like any pictures of water? Is there vases with water and flowers?
Yeah. So you guys want to leave and go check that out?
I just want to look quick to see.
Well, so you'd have to leave, go down the hallway, go back into the area where those ballrooms are, and then go over to that ballroom because you went down a hallway, and so these little offices like the dark room and the housekeeping primary office, you know, they're tucked down this hallway. So you'd have to come back out the hallway, go back to the main area, and then look into the ballroom.
There's probably a restroom right nearby that we
can get. Right, I just wanted the closest.
We need some sort of vessel to carry one.
Yeah, there's a public restroom nearby.
I have an idea. I don't know if it'll help. And I take off my jacket and I put it in the sink and I'm soaking my jacket and my shirt and I put it back on so I have some water on my clothing.
Okay.
Pants, whatever I could do. Go. I keep cutting off.
Yeah. Caitlin Bronson's seminar was at. Is that nearby? We need to go there. We need to find the
18th tablet. Floor or 17th floor.
Oh, that's right. We have to get there. The tablets of the most importance.
Well, we were hoping we had pictures of them. Did we?
Well, I mean, you had a few pictures that you collected from Caitlin's desk, the photos with the little notes attached to them. So there was the Shabati figure picture.
Oh, no, I meant the ones that we just had.
Yeah, and there's a you have those pictures as well.
But are any of them of the tablet?
Not a clear enough. It was too far away.
Well, I don't know that that's going to be all sealed off because of the murder.
Maybe we don't have to say the prayer. Maybe we can just present the prayer, the tablet, on top of the case that we seal in honey with the thing in it. It's our only hope. I don't speak ancient Egyptian. Do any of you?
I speak Arabic, but it would be a different form of...
Well, if Imhotep Ibn Hotep was from, what was it, the 18th dynasty, then he might be familiar with Latin and Greek.
Which I speak both of also.
Does the tablet look Greek?
It looked hieroglyphic.
Yeah. Oh, hieroglyphic. Okay, that's right.
It's definitely Egyptian.
What if we put him in the bag and throw it in the ocean? I mean, we're not far from the ocean.
Let's get up there. Let's talk while we walk.
The salt water might be bad for it, whatever it is. Like a snail in water, in salt water.
Okay.
What was that? That wasn't a breeze, was it?
That was me shaking my jacket out.
Oh, thank God.
So I'm wet. I'm like...
So are you guys heading for the elevator?
I don't want to go into that elevator. I want to go up the stairs. Oh, 18 floors, shit. What if we're in the elevator and that thing comes in?
What if we're in a stairwell and the thing comes in?
We can run.
Well, good point. I think at this point, let's take the stairs.
All right. We could take the train.
Okay, so you guys want to head to the stairwell? All right, so you have to you exit into the hallway, and the stairwell is located at the other end, so you have to go down this hallway to the main area and then head down a different hallway to get to the stairwell that runs the full height of the building. So you guys head down this hallway to the main area, and you were going to cross over and then go down a different hallway. As you get into that main area, you stop for a moment because you see a gentleman standing in front of the elevators waiting for the elevator, and Muffykins is right next to the gentleman, and the gentleman is dressed in like denim coveralls and stuff and has like a work shirt and everything, and he looks, you know, by the short hair and the sandy color, he looks just like the corpse that was being drained when you were in the maintenance area. But this guy looks very much alive. And as you guys come into this lobby area, he just kind of turns his head and looks at you guys and has this deep rumbling chuckle. And Muffykins steps up to the guy. So the elevator doors now open. And before he steps into the elevator, Muffykins gets closer to that guy. And Muffykins just kind of and is absorbed into the guy. And he seems to get a couple inches taller. And then he strides into the elevator, and the elevator doors close again. Give me another sand roll for seeing that.
Well, can I yell something before he, the doors
absolutely
close? Yeah. I'm going to yell something in Greek. I'm going to yell, Imhotep, we know who you are, and we're going to stop you.
Okay. Yeah, you yell that. And so as he starts to step into the elevator, he stops and hears you, and again, that deep rumbling chuckle, and he says something back in Greek and steps into the elevator. So those of you who know Greek, give me a Greek roll. Well, first off, what is your Greek?
40.
Okay, that's conversational.
65.
Oh, well, it's more
my native language.
No role necessary for a simple conversation. So as he steps into the elevator, he replies in Greek, "You are welcome to try." And then he steps into the elevator and lets the doors close.
Okay, and I miserably failed twice.
All right, so if you fail the sand roll, roll a D2. If you were successful, lose 0.
And I stagger back. I'm like, he speaks Greek.
Yes, he does.
I told him that we would stop him, and he said, we're welcome to try. I think he is more than what he is now. He is more than just himself. He is Muffykins and possibly others.
He's at least 3 or 4 people.
So the lady next to my room.
I am wondering if we should simply seal the doors of this building.
Dr. Caitlin, my room, the lady next door, Muffykins, the engineer.
If one of us, do you remember the table that had the little statues? If one of us runs in and tries to hopefully find the red jasper statue, it might make you invisible to him.
Agreed.
The tablet
has the prayer. Maybe, I'm guessing, I don't even know if it has the prayer. The photograph had the notes saying something about the prayer, but the notes did not stipulate the tablet had the prayer. Did it? Question for the keeper.
The notes did not stipulate that the tablet had the prayer.
And so
with archaeology, you can, I'll let you have another archaeology roll on this.
Oh, cool. Get to fail at something else. Okay, here we go. My smashing archaeology roll of 61. 32.
Okay. Because I feel like enough time has gone by and you've been ruminating on this enough to warrant this new role. It occurs to you that the prayer, the Isis prayer, is just, it's a simple blessing. There is no specific wording for an Isis prayer. An Isis prayer can be, as your education has taught you, it can be as simple as a blessing of good health, of a blessing of protection, any kind of simple blessing that invokes the protection of Isis.
Oh, and with my pretty extensive archaeological background, I'd probably know of some
colloquial
prayers of such.
Please, in the name of Isis, please keep this safe. And that is a blessing for Isis.
Wonderful. Right?
Something as simple as that.
Oh. This could work, guys. What do you think? I relay this immediately to my colleagues here.
Do you have that? Isis artifact? Didn't we see
the necklace?
Yeah.
The Knot of Isis. Yeah, we have it.
So Barnabas. I heard you say the word artifact, and I just want to clear, you know, because since we're obviously not playing in real space with each other, and I can't share actual handouts. So the Knot of Isis necklace that was found in Dr. Bronson's hotel room, that is a modern silver icon on a silver chain. There is a second necklace that is an artifact that you discovered. There's a photograph and a paper-clipped note that came from Dr. Barnabas's desk, and that is the one that was labeled Ibinhotep's scarab amulet. And she talked about how there was weird writing on some of the gold squares of the necklace that are clearly not Egyptian. All of her research could never decipher it. She hypothesized that it was a cipher of some sort, probably etched by Ibinhotep himself, and that whatever the translation is must have been lost to time. So that was one thing, one photograph and note paper clipped together. The other one was about the Shabati figurine, the red jasper one, and then the other one was about how the tablet talked about how if you had a container and sealed with honey and did a prayer to Isis, it could contain, you know, supposedly that is how the ancient Egyptians contained the spirit of Ibinhotep in a canopic jar.
Okay. Yeah. I was mixing up. I was thinking that.
Yeah. And I sensed that. So I wanted to clarify. I want to kind of clear the field on that.
All right. So I don't say anything with that then. Tom, you were going to say something?
I don't remember.
I'm sorry.
No, that's okay.
Okay, so you guys have just seen this guy, this weird dude, Ibinhotep, I don't know, looking like the maintenance dude, reanimated. Muffikins absorbed into him. You know, you guys taunted each other in Greek. He stepped into the elevator, and you can see it dinging and ticking as it's gone its way up.
It's going up to maybe the 18th floor. Do any of you remember seeing a large coffin there? Was it on exhibit?
A sarcophagus?
Yeah.
There was no sarcophagus because everything in this exhibit was travel sized, you know, for easy movement.
Is there a sprinkler system inside this building?
Yes. But it's only engineered to major common areas. It's not engineered into hotel bedrooms yet. They plan for that expansion in a few years.
I'm wondering if you place a blessing of Isis upon the water and turn the water on, if this will slow him down at least. We're going to have to run up the stairs to get to the 18th floor.
We need that red jasper.
If he's in the other elevator going up, we might as well just jump in and get up there.
I think he can be in multiple places at once, don't you know?
I think he needs to have a form in that area. If we get in now, he might be there two floors before us.
We need to go. We need to get as much as we can salvaged from there.
Right.
And at least one of us may be hidden from it if we use that red jasper.
Suddenly become very nervous about being in a very tight, small, closed space. It's like being in a grave.
It's quite spacious, though. Look, Dr. Lasko. Look, it's a full 6 feet across.
I'm tempted to blow on him. Yeah. I will go, but I don't think it is a great idea, but we must stop this thing. I don't know how. Didn't seem to like the water. If it goes into the same place where we were, the ballroom, then there may be sprinklers in there.
Good point.
Do we know from being on the 18th floor that the 17th floor connects to the 18th floor?
Sure.
Do you want to get out on the 17th and take those little stairs that we walked past up?
Well, maybe to keep, because he might be waiting for us at the 18th floor door.
That's what I'm thinking.
Of course, he will see the thing stop at the 17th floor, so.
I don't know if he'll be waiting for us. I think he might just think we're inconsequential. We might be just like gnats to him.
We're getting close. Ding, ding, you know.
Yeah. I am not so sure.
Make a decision. Do I press 17 or no?
Yes.
17.
17 and 18 are pressed.
Okay. The car stops on 17.
All right. Let's get out and go up the stairs.
Okay. You get out. There's no one here. And you know that little stairwell that kind of goes up to an area that's like on the back side of 18. And so you can go over to the main ballroom that way. So you guys do that. You head over to the stairs.
Yes.
As you're heading over to the stairs, you're kind of going up it. You hear what sounds like a semi-loud. It sounds muffled, but you hear a pop, just one. You hear one pop sound.
Like a gunshot pop or like a...
Possibly.
Photograph, a light bulb, or
less like a photograph or light bulb.
Pop. Is somebody, maybe a security guard, is shooting at Ibn Hotep?
We gotta find that idol.
Yeah, we need to stay focused to the conference room or wherever we were at, where the
the grand ballroom.
Yeah, grand ballroom.
All right, so you guys finish going up the stairs so you're now on 18?
Yeah.
All right, so you go through this like smaller ballroom area, you know, ballroom air quotes. But you go through that, and now you kind of, it leads to the lobby area where the elevators are, and the grand ballroom is just beyond. As you come into that lobby area where the elevators let out, you do see a police officer, one of the Providence uniformed officers who must have been stationed up here. He's dead. He's desiccated on the floor, and you can see his pistol, his service revolver, is still in his hand, the barrel smoking, and he's all desiccated. But you didn't actually see him murdered. And you've seen this before, so no sand rolls to see him. And then there's the ballroom doors, and they are ajar. And inside, you can hear the crashing and thrashing of stuff.
All right. Look, I'm going to go to the door to look in.
All right. You look in, and there you see the maintenance man. And he seems to be... In a furious, agitated state, as he reaches down and will grab a table and flip it out of the way. And I mean, as he flips it, that table just starts somersaulting through the air and then smashes and falls to the ground on the far side of the ballroom. And when he reaches down to grab the table, you know, he reaches down, but of course, you know, our arms don't, from a standing position, our arms don't touch the floor, but he only rolls his shoulders forward just a little bit. And then it's almost like his arm is elastic, and it stretches down and the hand widens out so he can get a large giant grip on that table and then recoil and flip as it just kind of, he tosses it out of the way, and a few bits of trinkets, you know, kind of fling along as well with it. And he's, you know, frustratingly trying to wade his way through the absolute mess that was made of this room during the robbery attempt.
He's missing something.
He's looking for that scarab amulet. I am going to climb up onto the nearest table, and I'm going to pull out my lighter, and I'm going to hold it to the sprinkler head, the nearest okay. one.
Darius is climbing onto furniture. What do you guys want to do?
Okay. This creature, Ibn Hotep, was in the canopic jar when this was all nice and neat and we were looking at it earlier. Do we recall, does Thurston recall where that necklace was with the onyx, the black onyx scarab?
Because
that's something we may have over Ibn Hotep, is the knowledge of where to look.
Okay, give me an idea roll.
Ugh, phooey, drats. It's failed by lots.
It's somewhere over there, and you're basically gesturing the entire room. It's over there. Does anyone else want to try and pick their gray matter and see if they can remember where that is?
Oh, wait, I could try a push.
Or you could burn luck.
It would be a tremendous amount of luck. I got an 86. Could I push and burn a little luck pushing?
Well, so if you choose to push, there's no luck burn on a push.
Okay, I will burn all that luck. All right.
Okay.
Okay. 20. 5. Okay. Ouch. Ouch, that's heavy. Heavy luck burn. Okay.
All right. You do recall the table that was featuring the Ibn Hotep scarab amulet, and it was by a pillar over on the far side of the room over there, and you can see that Ibn Hotep, in the guise of the maintenance man, he is making a general, slightly meandering path towards that area, so that given enough time, he is going to find it. But clearly, he doesn't know where it is, so he's trying to make a methodical search as he goes.
Okay, I will. If he's on one side, I will arch around and go to where I best think it is.
Okay, so you're going to do that, Barnabas. Searching.
And I make a roll to see if I remember where that Jasper statue was.
Absolutely. Go ahead. And because you guys actually visited that table, you can do an idea roll with a bonus die.
Nice. First roll is a 19. Second roll was 79, so 19.
Okay. Yeah, you know exactly where it is. In fact, Ibn Hotep just moved past it. But it is like with, you know, it's like within 5 feet of him, but it's behind him. He just stepped past those Shabbati figurines because he doesn't care about them.
So, Lasko, you're up about lighting the thing, right?
I'm trying to set off the sprinklers.
So I tell Thursby, I'm going to go for the Jasper idol. You're going to make your way there. If I get it, I'm going to attempt to distract him. I don't know if he could see me, but maybe even if I throw another table, he'll move back away. This is
good idea.
Hopefully. If not, I'm going to run like hell. All right.
Okay. So I need Darius to give me a luck roll. I need Thurston to give me a dex roll. And I need Barnabas to give me a dex roll.
Ooh. I got an 18.
Three. All right, you're very lucky.
That's better than half.
I got 58 out of 55. Can I burn some luck?
Absolutely.
Okay. So I would pass.
Thurston?
I did an extreme pass.
Oh, all right. Thurston is not only looping around, Thurston's also using those heavy drapes that are on the windows. He's using them as cover. So he's like slipping behind them, and he's moving his way without being seen. Barnabas, he runs forward and kind of does a slide on his knees and comes right up to the pile of Shabbati figurines, and there's the red jasper right there in front of you. And just at that moment, Darius, who's standing up there flicking his bick, and then finally he's able to melt that little piece of filament, and suddenly it triggers the sprinkler system, and so water starts to rain down into this room. No klaxon, though, is blaring, but the mechanics of triggering that sprinkler system are successful. So now it's raining here.
Does Maintenance Hotep have a reaction to the water all of a sudden?
Well, he stops as he seems to recognize and feel that it is water, and he looks up at it. And then he looks back and he notices Dr. Darius now for the first time as being in this room. And he begins to speak to you in Greek. Again, because your Greek is so high and this is just conversational stuff, no role is necessary. And so he looks at you and he says, you show extraordinary bravery in this strange new world. You shall be the first of my slaves in this new realm that shall be ruled by Ebenhotep. You should consider yourself lucky.
You should understand that slavery has been done away with for 1,000 years, you fool. Nobody will follow you.
Barnabas, you have Red Jasper Shabbati figurine in hand. Thurston, you have made it to the table, and there is the Ebenhotep scarab amulet right there on the floor.
Grab it.
All right. You grab it. What do you want to do with it?
Put it in my inside pocket and...
Well, this thing is, it's big. I mean, this is, you know, it's almost like a formal dress wear, you know, because the squares, there's five of them. So they, you know, two, and then the fifth one. So it's big. It drapes on you. It weighs probably 10 pounds. I mean, it's got weight to it.
Does it look like the clasp mechanism is still sturdy?
The aperture for your head, I mean, it's so big, you just drop it on because it's so large.
You're talking about the Egyptian thing that sort of goes all the way across.
Okay. All right. So then I'll carry it that way. I'll put it on.
Okay.
And then I'll start backing away quickly from Ebenhotep.
Okay. Barnabas, what are you doing with the Shabbati figure in hand?
I'm going to hold it in my hand and whisper, Isis, please protect me from this evil. Isis, please protect me from this evil. Touch it to my forehead and stand up and see if he sees me.
Ebenhotep is like practically within arm's reach, and he's having a taunting conversation with Dr. Darius. And while he's not looking directly at you, that's only because you're not standing directly in the line of path between him and Dr. Darius, but you are so close to that eyesight, that eye line, he should be seeing you. It's not like you're way off in his peripheral and maybe it's questionable. No. You are basically right there. He should be reacting to you. He is not reacting to you. Thurston. My good friend Thurston. Okay. Himini ha. Ha ha ha.
Uh-oh. He's saying himini ha. That means...
I'm picturing my head looking like the German at the end of Raiders of the Lost Ark, right?
okay. Thurston, give me a sand roll.
It's 22 right now. Oh, and I rolled a 68.
roll a d10.
Oh, it's a 6.
All right. You feel a numbness and strange calm. It washes over you. You know, this entire ordeal was fueled by anxiety, fear, and you know, just you were running on adrenaline. Okay, you put this necklace on, and you feel like a shudder move through your body, and it brings a level of calmness to you, and that calmness is reinforced by the voice that is whispering to you. And this voice, it almost seems to convey centuries of information, of memory, in an instant. And you suddenly understand, and you don't just suspect, you know with a certainty that you have the ability to drink essence from those who are undeserving, those who are below your station. Okay. And you know that if you were to drink that essence, that it would revitalize you. You would feel amazing. You would gain their strength into you. And yes, it would reduce them to basically ash. But it's not like they were real people anyways, right? I mean, they're below your station. And so you have gained the knowledge, a deeper magic version of the spell shriveling.
It sounds reasonable. Just lesser people.
I want you to gain... gain 1d3 Cthulhu Mythos. Oh no! How much did you roll for your sanity?
When I failed my sanity,
yeah. Six, right?
My loss.
Yeah, your loss was six.
Six.
Yeah, I lost six.
Yeah, so you lost those six sanity points, but I want you to gain six Cthulhu Mythos.
Oh, okay. One second. Oh, that's kind of cool. Before I die, but let's see. Okay.
So there you go. You have your birthright.
I don't feel compelled to start draining my companions, do I?
No, but you know that it is almost enough to know that you can. It's up to you to decide if and when you should.
Okay. They seem like good people.
For now. God forbid they should want that necklace, though. You know, I'm just saying.
So,
all right. So you have Ibn-Hotep's scarab amulet. Give me a luck roll, Thurston.
Oh, I just burnt so much of my luck. O-1. I got an O-1.
Okay. So Ibn-Hotep is enthralled in a conversation with Dr. Darius. You also see Barnabas standing nearby, but Ibn-Hotep is paying him no heed whatsoever.
The world has changed, Imhotep. It is not the world that you know before. There are no kingdoms. There are no slaves. There are no followers of grand leaders. The pyramids are falling to dust. It is
as
a different
sun,
world.
With the rising of the new sun, the world shall change again.
No.
A world of my making.
There are no longer any people that will follow.
They will all follow. They will all follow or die.
did the flash of knowledge that burst through me give me any sense that I could feed off of Imhotep?
I don't see why you couldn't. Yeah, you didn't get a flash of knowledge saying that you could. You also didn't get one saying that you couldn't.
Then while Dr. Lasko keeps his attention elsewhere, I will approach from behind and attempt to drain its essence.
All right. Yes, I'm Barnabas.
Backing up, oh, not towards Lasko, because I know he could see Lasko, but maybe 15 feet to the left or right of Lasko.
Say that again. I didn't understand what you were talking about.
So you have the what's his name? Hotep is there. I'm going to back away towards Dr. Lasko.
But okay.
Stand directly. I want to give a 10 or 15 foot berth of Lasko. So
okay.
We'll be parallel, but I'm not going to be standing right next to him.
All right. So Lasko, not Thurston.
Correct. I want to be away from.
Okay. So yeah, you're standing over by Dr. Darius.
Right. Sorry if that didn't come out right.
No. I got it now. So you move over towards Darius, Dr. Lasko. And so Thurston, you're trying to creep up behind Imhotep.
It sounds perfectly sane for someone who has a sanity of 16.
I totally agree. So because of all the mess and clutter in here, I'm going to need a stealth roll in order to get over to him without being heard.
Stealthy bankers, here we come. Oh, I can burn the last of my luck. I'm going to burn.
Sweet.
23. All right. Wow. Okay, I make it. I'm stealthy.
All right. So, Dr. Lasko and Imhotep are having this maniacal, evil villain monologuing in Greek, and you come up behind him, you stealthily work your way up behind him, and you're right there, and you touch. All right, you start doing the drain. Okay, lose 10 magic points. Lose 5 sanity points.
Oh, no. And magic points that bleed it past 0 go to hit points.
Correct.
Let's take it out of hit points.
So blood starting to come out of my eyes, ears, and nose at this point.
But you're going to be revitalized from
down to 11 san. All right. Okay.
All right. And so as you start draining him, new eyeballs begin to pop and open up on the back of his head, and a new mouth opens up on the back of his head as he starts to scream, and you're holding on as you're draining him and draining him, and he starts to be reducing down as he's turning into and all of his features are turning grainy and sandy as all of this energy is pouring into you, and you're taking him for everything that he's worth. You're just draining him down into nothingness. I want you to regain all of your health, all of your hit points, go back up to full.
Wow.
I want you to roll 2d6. So roll 2d6 once and then roll 2d6 again.
9 and 5.
Increase your strength by 9 and increase your con by 5.
Strength. 9, con, 5. Wow. Ooh.
And we may have to recalculate your hit points. And so you just start taking him down, 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 and he's turning back into a sandy mixture. What do you guys do?
I am continuing to taunt him as I jump down from the table and walk towards him. I'm like, and do you not think that in the last 3,000 years we haven't found ways to counteract all of your foolish magic? As he's shrinking down, and I'm gonna, you want to get the chance, I'm gonna scoop him into the case.
Okay, Barnabas.
Why don't we put him back in the original container?
It's broken.
Right, and we put it on and seal it with the honey.
But it's broken into pieces.
I thought it just had a shatter off the top.
Anyway, no, it broke into three big pieces.
Okay.
All right, so you start scooping him into the trunk?
Yeah.
Into the suitcase? All right. You scoop him up into it. You know, you've... Thurston is drunk with power.
Zipper it, and then smear honey on the zipper.
Yep, on the leather strapping and the edges where it was, right? Okay.
Now we need a blessing. Thurston, you look like you could probably give a blessing at this point in time.
His soul tasted so good.
Can I do a sanity roll?
I have a question. Can Thurston see me?
You know what? Yeah, Thurston. Yes. Yeah, it's only you and Dr. Darius. Dr. Darius Lasko.
Thurston?
Hey, Thurston.
I'm trying to get Darius's attention. Like, I'm going like this.
And I just sort of do this. I put my hands on the suitcase.
Okay.
And I say, may the blessings of Isis seal this container to not allow Ibn Hotep to escape again.
All right. Okay. Nice.
Thurston, can you please take off the big necklace?
Why? Doesn't it look good on me?
Yes, it looks lovely on you, but I'm afraid you have suffered a bad shock, and I sort of look over. I keep my eyes on Thurston, but I sort of motion for Barnabas. Get the necklace off of him. You seem to have been overcome, Thurston.
Is it possible for me to make a POW check to see if I have any presence of mind left to rip this thing off of me?
Sure. Sure. I'm going to say it has to be a sand roll. So make a sand roll.
Oh, no. A sand roll, not a POW. Yeah, this won't work.
Sand.
Oh, my gosh. Okay.
Nice.
I did it. Oh my god.
Yeah, sorry, so you guys. have this moment of clarity. Like you feel like you might be you are risking by holding on to this necklace, you risk your soul tumbling into a hole that you would never be able to get out of. You feel that sensation.
If any of that presence, I rip this thing off of me and throw it as far away as I can.
No, don't throw it. It goes into a museum.
Yeah, so you're able to get the necklace off you and dash it to the ground.
I'm standing behind you, like just about to pounce as he did it. I'm like,
Yeah, and then you're kind of startled because Barnabas is right there in your peripheral.
We think that you may have been possessed by the spirit of Ibn Hotep, but he's in there now. What do we do with the suitcase?
Who's that guy over at the university?
Are you talking about Henry Armitage?
There you go. I think we should just get the suitcase, grab that thing, and get into a taxi and get the heck out of here.
Well, I don't want them to open it. I think that we need to put it someplace where it will never, ever be opened.
But, I don't know.
I thought at first it was just an animal, but it is obviously not an animal.
Oh, no, definitely not.
So I think what we'll do is we'll go ahead and kind of sunset here and congratulate our players for a successful ending. I will go ahead and say in every run of this scenario, which to my knowledge, I'm sure there are others by now, but to my knowledge, I am the only keeper to have run this scenario. And in all of the play tests and official runnings that I've done, this is the first successful destroy the creature and get it back into a case. Every other game ends in insanities, TPKs, or there's enough of a we don't know what to do, and the creature basically escapes and is never seen again. Nice. But this is the first time Ibn Hotep has been defeated.
Wow.
Fantastic.
This was awesome. Awesome. I had such a good time playing this with you guys.
Well, thank you very much for running this. This was
I look great. Forward to the next game that you
Yes.
Yes.
All right. Our players included Stuart Lipley, Jason Melnichok, and myself with John Hook as the Keeper of the Secrets. We're currently producing up to 4 shows a week with music and sound effects added in post-production in order to create a richer listener experience. We provide audio-only versions of our shows free for you to download from Podbean or iTunes. The costs involved with the show are provided almost entirely by our patrons. Without them, we wouldn't be able to do what we do. If you'd like to help support our show, please visit our Patreon account. Just $1 or $2 a month helps us a lot. You can find a link in the description below. Like, share, and subscribe to our channel and punch that bell icon for updates on our latest shows. And leave us some comments. We enjoy reading them and answer any questions you might have. We also have an Into the Darkness Facebook group where you can chat with us and the other members of our club. There is also a link below for that. This is Tom Rayleigh together with all the members of our gaming club inviting you to journey with us once again into the darkness for another adventure into the universe of H.P. Lovecraft and the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. Until next time, good luck. Good gaming.